That had absolutely nothing to do with the video. I just needed some sort of intro. I didn't have one. So let the intro be this. And without further ado, roll the intro credits, baby.
In the jungle, the mighty jungle, the lion sleeps tonight. In the jungle, the cry.
Group theory. That noise. But sometimes to get where you're going, you just gotta go there, as I like to say. Groups are what I need to know. I gotta give you a bit of a confession. I have a bit of a affinity to engineering. I know. I get it. Engineers, you, right? But actually, I think at heart, I do like building stuff. Building stuff is definitely a tougher thing. In going to build stuff in the modern day, you need a lot of mathematics. The first thing I tried was understanding the computers, which actually worked. I'm gonna do a whole course on that, but they make sense. Don't get too confused. There are a lot of parts, but they build up from very simple, small building blocks. So yeah, that's why I went into abstract algebra, was I was reading about operating systems, and they use a lot of abstract algebra terms, even in compilers and stuff, just a lot of abstract algebra was used everywhere, and it just got really annoying, so I dive in. And when I dove in, it's really confusing. So I gotta go run and get some firewood with my grandpa right now, but when I get back, I will go over what I learned from rings, fields, and groups. I only read the first pages, but I have an idea of what abstract algebra is, so I'm gonna give you my understanding going in, and then hopefully over time, I'll go over how my understanding changes. But again, I gotta run, go get some firewood. Maybe I'm gonna film some of that, I don't know. See you after that.
Near the village, the peaceful village, the lion sleeps tonight. Near the village, the quiet village, the lion sleeps tonight.
Alright, and got a little carried away there with the cinematic edit. What can you do? Fun fact, a 10% crop on the top and bottom makes any shot look more cinematic, so use that at your discretion. I tend to ramble. I made about 4 of these so far, and when I watch them back, they go up, down, left, right, and center, which might be good for a live stream, but we are trying to make an edited video here, and the editing version of me in 20 minutes will hate the video-making version of me if I ramble a ton, which has happened multiple times before. So I'm gonna hold this piece of paper. It has the points I'm trying to say here, and then we're gonna cut it there, so keep it, you know, within reason. But man, can I just go on, especially when I'm talking to myself to a camera, just boom, bing, bop, bop, all over the place. But yeah, live stream. We're not live streaming right now, but one day, I think pretty soon, we might start. But today is not that day. So we are going over rings, fields, and groups. I read literally just the first sets and proofs methods chapter. I think it's up to page 12. And then we moved on to the groups, and I got to that too. He kind of goes over, but his style is actually pretty good, I would say. He gives motivation for things. I would rank this as a happenstance pick. You saw the one where I was rushing the library trying to pick it. So the happen that I got this one in particular is quite lucky. It's quite prudent. Quite provident. Has a certain providence associated with it. Love that word. I think it's a Ben Franklin. That's like a 1700s American word. Providence. Rhode Island, I think. Yeah, see how I get rambling? Okay, where was I going? All right, yeah, number one. Number one piece of advice, if you're learning mathematics right now, higher level, get goaded with sets. You wanna be understanding sets as if you understand the letter A. Understand it as a language. Sets are so unbelievably crucial that they're the language that math got rewrote in. Math was kind of like, and they all kind of agreed to make it in the language of sets. I forget exactly when this happened, but at the core of most math now is sets. You talk in terms of sets of things, sets of numbers, sets of functions, sets of axioms, sets of logical something. Like, it just, we talk in sets, and then I don't even know like what they use sets for in a lot of different things, but you kind of expect that a modern, refined mathematical field is going to be talking in terms of sets. Now there's simple sets, set theory, which is just learning the language of sets, like here's inclusion, union, bada bing, bada boom. It's just like words, and like this, so like this is in this set, blah, 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 and that's pretty okay. And then there's like an infinite weird set theory. I think they call it axiomatic set theory, and there's this one called the axiom of choice, which I have no idea what that is. I've read about it, but it makes no sense. So I gotta go into that at some point, but right now it doesn't really seem that necessary. It just seems confusing because it deals with a lot of strange paradoxes, which don't really bother me. But that's just me personally, like the barber thing with Bertrand Russell. I won't get into that. Say, staying on topic, second thing went through with contrapositive proof. Now, contrapositive proof is, that's gonna be another video, but it's another way of proving a statement. So in logic, you have something, you say this thing implies this thing. You have, I'm blanking. I stubbed my toe and then I said ouch. And so I said ouch. Every time I stub my toe, I say ouch. Contrapositive proof is a way of proving that statement by doing a weird trick. It's going, instead of proving that directly, instead of saying providing some proof that every time you stub your toe, you say ouch, instead you go, instead you go,
in the jungle, the mighty jungle.
You've said ouch from your toe. Maybe I'll cut that out. I got a whole explanation planned out for that. Contrapositive proof. It bothers me. I don't like proving things as contrapositive. It's just a useful trick to prove things, and it bothers a lot of people, actually. It's not just me. It doesn't feel like as valid as like a direct proof. It's kind of like a trick, and you're just like, okay, yeah, I guess that's true, but it's not as satisfying. Anywho, logic fits on the axiomatic tree. So logic, I haven't gone into it yet, but as far as I can tell, if you watch my axiomatic video, you have like axioms, things. This isn't my creation. This has been around for a while, but you got axioms, you got proofs, you got theorems, right? And the proofs, like those lines, is what logic is. The study of logic is a study of how you draw those lines up to prove things. So there's axioms, theorems, theorems on theorems, theorems on theorems, right, etc. The lines, the study of those lines, how you draw those lines, what the rules are for like how you draw those lines and what those lines are, is the study of logic. Yeah, just an interesting tidbit for mapping it out. And last but not least, as I got to the first chapter on groups, an insight that kind of popped to mind is, because axioms always bothered me, especially in abstract algebra, because the axioms aren't as intuitive as Euclidean geometry, where it's just draw a circle, and it's like, let's go, yeah, no parallel lines, got it, sweet. It gets all like, bam, bam, thank you, ma'am. Between two points, you can draw a line, it's like, right on, makes sense, that's a nice axiom, I can trust that, I'm pretty sure that's real, even though we know that, like, geometry gets all fuzzy, and then there's, like, non-Euclidean geometries that are also equally valid, and it's just like, okay, whatever. But for me, in experience, it's like, yeah, those axioms make sense. In algebra, it starts getting just whack. The axioms do not make any intuitive sense from the get-go. It's like the associative law has it's tough to map to like a direct experience. But the axioms are kind of just this way, they're the seeds on, we look at algebraic structures, we look at, and the last video I made was on algebra, so that should be clear, but there's like combinations of things, and the axioms are kind of ways of describing how you combine stuff. They're the simplest rules we can come up with the different structures we found, because it's very complicated. Like algebra is like, you know, a set of 10 elements can have like 100 different combinations, and it's all like this weird pattern. And so like the best way we can come up with to describe those patterns is with axioms, but it's a different, for me it feels like a different type of axiom. It's like it's a descriptive axiom than like a base level truth axiom. It's like an axiom we drilled down to and found, but it doesn't have the same appeal as like a circle drawing around in Euclidean geometry. But they're like the simplest possible descriptors, we can't get any simpler, to describe an algebra. And they're like, the set of things is the dirt, and the axioms are the seeds, and then the axioms will make a tree. Because like you have three axioms, and then it causes this whole ripple effect of structure in the algebra, so that then different rules apply and whatnot. But still, the algebraic axioms bother me, but that's just the way it is. Yeah! Math, boys. All right, that's gonna be it. Without further ado, take it easy. I love ya. Godspeed, and I will see you in the next one, which is going to be tomorrow.